If you've never heard of José Limón or seen his work, all you need to do is see a brief glimpse of his profile to know that this is someone out of the ordinary. He was powerful like no other man I had ever seen dance. You would have to rank José Limón in the top 10 dance artists of the 20th century. He's changed the way we look at movement in this world.
I would say that that first impact with José was very powerful, very fascinating, and I knew immediately that I had encountered a major force in dance.
The fabric of American dance was created and is still being sewn upon and growing through our pioneers, and Limón was a pioneer.
In his work, I saw a wonderful kind of lyricism and a strength. He is among the top 10 performers of the American stage, particularly in modern dance. He brought you to his humanity, his understanding of the vulnerability and humaneness of this world.
The thing that marked José out as a dancer was the moral certitude of his presence. He brought this overwhelming, brooding power. It was not a figure that you would ever take lightly.
Usually when I see great dancing, my concern isn't where you're from. It is, can you dance? Can you move me? He moved me.
He fulfilled something in modern dance because of his masculinity and because of his race. He fulfilled something that was inclusive and new, hopeful. He affirmed something.
That almost deathly seriousness was perhaps a limitation, but limitation or not, it was enormously effective and impressive.
Dance for every single human experience. Early in our adventure, as humans in this planet, very early, even before language was invented, we had the supremely instinctual urge and capacity to dance.
In America, modern dance began as a reaction to the perceived elitism of European ballet and was influenced by two major impulses: the urge to help shape humanity and the desire to generate a revolutionary art form. Bridging the debate between these often conflicting priorities was José Limón.
I'd like to tell you something about the art of the dance as we practice it. We like to go to human experience to tell us what to do. We like to go to all of the joys and the sorrows and the doubts and the terrors and the incertitudes of modern life for our inspiration. Now, you know perfectly well that not all of life is pleasant. So consequently, often we deal with very serious and very tragic subjects. Now, in order to do this, we have had to evolve a new vocabulary of gesture, of movement.
Before his death in 1972, Limon began to write his autobiography, which he did not live to finish.
After meeting at one fiesta or another, my father, a musician and widower of 35, courted the girl of 15. The wedding was in April of 1907. On January 12, 1908, kicking like a roped steer, I, Jose Limon, was delivered. My mother was further to give birth to 13 children, only 6 of whom would survive.
Limon's birth was in the city of Culiacán, state of Sinaloa, Mexico. The country was on the cusp of a revolution which would propel the family in a series of moves northward. Having begun as a middle-class revolt, it developed into a peasant-led battle that fought for land reform, universal suffrage, and an end of foreign economic control.
It was during the revolution. We all used to sleep on the floor. And there's only one bed there for my father and my mother. One of my uncles was staying with us. You could hear the shots.
Jose was 5 years old when the revolution caught up with the family in Cananea.
The family was at breakfast. Gunfire interrupted the meal. At first, it was thought to be firecrackers. In Mexico, the saints like their festivals full of music, processions, and fireworks. Bullets began to shatter the window panes and whistle into the room. Everyone hit the floor except my gallant young uncle. He looked out of the window. My father and grandmother shouted for him not to be a fool, to take cover.
I could hear my grandmother tell him, lie down, lie down. And he didn't mind. Well, a bullet came through the window and shot him a shot on the forehead.
During a brief truce, the Red Cross picked up my half-dead uncle and took him to the hospital where he died. Cowering under a mattress, with the incessant sound of rifles and cannon, I first encountered fear. Fear raised to the pitch of pure animal terror. The bright, bloody pool congealed like a crimson halo around the head of my prostrate uncle and had a horrid and irresistible fascination.
My dad was such a quiet man when it came to his background, because he being a white man, and in Mexico they're predominantly Indian, and he had a great feeling for the Indian people, meaning economically and being oppressed. He saw the oppression of the people in Mexico by the church, because the church and the authorities were always one and the same. And they, in turn, carry out programs that they shouldn't under the guise of religion. Think as I did, there's nothing wrong with religion, it's just what men do to it. They bend it for their own purpose.
My father, with a family to support, accepted the post of director of military bands to several revolutionary caudillos of the north. He served the generals who were later elevated to presidents of the republic. What he saw while accompanying them on their campaigns convinced him that we would have to emigrate to the United States. My baby brother, Gilberto, became very ill on the train that took us north. He cried pitifully during the long, slow ride. The train was crowded beyond belief. All social distinctions and barriers were forgotten. Our caravan included the inevitable regiment of soldiers. At one of the stops, we were witness to the execution of a man. There was a procession. The doomed man asked for a cigarette. My mother lit candles before the crucifix, imploring for some miraculous intercession. Finally, the sound of the volley and the desolation of a woman weeping. There was no doctor on the train. I could see my mother becoming desperate. Someone played an accordion, sad, melancholy. It was sunset. My mother's face, the crying of my baby brother, my frightened sister Dora and little brother Jesus, the lost train, the brutal landscape. How this memory lies in ambush to assault and torment me when I least expect it. I was about to become an exile in a strange country. I soon learned that I was to be for the rest of my life a translator and conciliator. It was to be my task to translate perpetually within myself the tongue of Castile to that of the Anglo-Saxons, to reconcile many contradictory cultural habits. I do not know to what extent the violence I had witnessed early in my life and the unspeakable fear of confronting the unknown have warped and maimed my spirit. I can only speculate. To us who had known only small cities, Los Angeles was awesome in the extreme. It was to become our permanent home.
My father was working as a musician, and he earned very little money, and we were destitute. And Jose was the one person who would do it all.
In time, my mother became pregnant again. As the pregnancy advanced, she became subject to acute suffering. And after an agonized crisis, she left this valley of tears at 34 years of age, leaving an inconsolable widower, a large brood of infants, and a brutally embittered firstborn.
When my mother was dying, she'd say, "My babies, mis hijos, mis hijos." Jose told her, "I'll take care of your babies, Mama, I'll take care of your babies."
In the hospital corridor, I, who had spent the final hours at my mother's deathbed in the cold dawn of April, confronted a broken man sobbing like a child and took a terrible and heartless revenge. "Why do you cry?" I asked. "You killed her, and God permitted you."
He suffered a lot, you know, he suffered a lot because he saw his mother having one child after the other and the misery of the poverty, because when you're born to an artist in those days, and this is one of the reasons I imagine he was so quiet.
Ever since she died, he was a sort of a very melancholy member. He just
I think
there,
my...
there was something missing
in his life. He just wasn't happy here anymore.
During my last year of high school, I became acquainted with three aspiring young artists who were living the strangely fascinating lives of the Bohemian. I would be invited to their studio, where bourgeois society and its values, pretensions, and hypocrisies were not merely dissected, but dismembered and annihilated. To my alarm, I found myself listening, and then, after much discomfort, beginning to agree.
Jose graduated from Abraham Lincoln High School with honors and decided to devote his life to painting.
My mother's death, my break with my father, my loss of religious faith were unmistakable signs that my young life was in a state of crisis. The boys, having moved to New York, would write to me of the artistic paradise they were discovering. This siren song proved irresistible. I took a long look at my life. The sad, sweet past, so ugly and so beautiful, was to be as dead from now on. One is born and reborn, just as one dies and dies again.
My dad said, "Why are you going to go to New York? People are starving and you're going to go to New York?"
I rode the streetcar to the end of the line, stuck out my thumb, and was picked up by a truck. And then one ineffable afternoon, I crossed the Hudson on the 125th Street ferry, and I was home. I was horrified at the speed of the subway. At the time, New York art schools and galleries were largely dominated by the Impressionists, Cubists, Surrealists, and Dadaists. What was discouraging was that everyone was imitating them. By some perverse irony, I found myself turning to El Greco. I studied his work, the more I came to the fatal recognition that this man had done all I had hoped to do in painting. This finished me off. I had been earning my living by running elevators, emptying garbage cans, tending furnaces, and posing for artists and art classes. Now, I didn't care anymore. The bottom had fallen out of my life. I spent my days loafing or going to the movies. All ambition was lost. A girl from Georgia with whom I was going at the time had tickets for a dance recital by Harold Kreutzberg. It was a packed house, the lights dimmed. Suddenly, onto the stage bounded an ineffable creature and did something which transformed me. I had not known that this existed. And now I did not want to continue on this earth unless I learned to do what this man was doing. My two friends from Los Angeles had both attended school with Charles Wideman. They recommended that I look into the school recently established by Doris Humphrey and himself. I showed up immediately. The young lady at the reception desk of the studio was Pauline Lawrence, the administrator, accompanist, costume designer, and backbone of the Humphrey Wideman studio.
After only a few months of classes, Jose was invited to participate in a performance, and not long after to become a member of the company.
The American modern dancers, just like the American contemporary painters of the 30s, particularly, or 20s also, were very, I think, beginning to feel very oppressed by the fact that America always turned to Europe for models. We have looked to Europe for so long, and if we kept on doing it, we would impoverish ourselves artistically. So we had to find new models. The interest in, say, Shaker American Indian images. Those preoccupied the painters as well.
We have inherited from our past in Europe all of the wonderful things that we have in our Western civilization, the things of Mozart, of Bach, of Shakespeare, of Goya, of Cervantes, Michelangelo. But we have a contribution to make too. We have certain things that happen to us in this great continent which are not at all European. We have many things to say as Americans. Now, we have taken the great language of the dance, the great academic or classic ballet, and given it an American inflection.
Getting to know Jose just as a company and a new company member was almost impossible. He was a rather private person, so we didn't see him. Everybody thought he was a bit arrogant, and I thought so at the time. He didn't sort of fraternize with us very much, not the way Doris and Charles did. So he was not the kind of person you really got to know.
For me, performing was a species of agony. By nature, I was shy, and by upbringing, reticent and formal. In my earlier life, the very idea of exchanging my conventional attire for a dancer's costume and prancing around in public would have killed me with shame.
I was sitting behind somebody, a couple, when he was rehearsing at the 16th Street Studio, which I thought came off very well. And this woman was sitting there, and she says, "He's like a mad stallion up there." She couldn't stand him. Loads of people can't stand Jose. Just a mad stallion. And so, yes, he is. And I like the mad stallion. That's the thing. Do you want this kind of energy? Do you want this kind of intensity? Do you want that kind of instrument that can be a mad stallion in human form? Do you want the mad stallion approach to emotional, human emotional problems? You're damn right. I mean, who needs this watered-down ballet?
The members of the Humphrey Wideman Company survived by touring, teaching, and performing in Broadway shows.
I was to make several excursions into commerce and dabble half-heartedly and most ineptly in what to me was a form of prostitution.
You need the actor, the musician, the dancer, to come and talk to you about things that are of the utmost importance to human existence.
People don't understand the poverty that was around in the 30s. Consolidated Edison kept turning off the lights. They didn't have the gas to cook with. They used candles to light the place.
Why that era existed with its unemployment and misery is no great mystery, and many of those driven to rebelliousness found in the doctrine of the Communist Party the panacea for the troubles of mankind. Certain members of the Humphrey Wideman Company were quite convinced that the time for revolution in New York City had come. All that was needed was solidarity, and the decayed capitalist system would join the czarist regime in well-deserved oblivion.
my daydreaming.
I have always, even to this day, grumbled about the privileged rich, their ostentation, their greed, their gross self-indulgence and callousness.
He gave me a book on the Irish Revolution, 1917-1918. It was about the struggle of people against oppression. And years later, I'm thinking, you know, that son of a gun, he was a liberal true and true as I am. And I couldn't believe that he was giving me a message when he gave me this book.
But we'll never have better.
After 8 years, I confronted my father once more. His robust carriage was gone. My pride and arrogance were annihilated by a compassion and tenderness more terrifying than all hatred and hostility. My brothers and sisters were quite grown up. I invited them to our concert. In my dressing room, my family looked shyly at me as if I were from another planet, but with love. And my father, looking very pleased, said to me, "Muy bueno, Pepe, muy bueno."
My dad would always refer to him as Jose, very formally, and then when he referred to him as Pepe, meaning, "I love you."
I had been planning for some years a series of solo dances on a Mexican subject. Five symbolic figures from Mexican history: Indio, Conquistador, Peón, Caballero, and Revolucionario. Blind worship of my artistic heroes gave way to a far from total acceptance of their work. Stirring uncomfortably in a dim recess of my awareness was a persistent question. Do you think that someday you could do better? On May the 10th, 1940, the papers announced the Nazi invasion of the West. In a choreographic culmination, a newsreel showed Adolf Hitler prancing and hopping in malevolent rapture on receiving news of the fall of France. And so began for me years of desperation. I saw that my association with Humphrey Weidman was ended. We had quite simply outgrown each other.
You know what the split was, because he and Charles had been together, of course, for years at the 10th Street Menage, as we used to call it, the 10th Street apartment. And so, apparently, Charles got infatuated with this Peter Hamilton. Jose says, "Either Charles, you better make your mind, it's either Pete or me." And so Charles made up his mind and said, "It's Pete." So that took Jose out of the company. And that was a terrible blow for the company, because all of a sudden their lead male dancer was gone.
After his break with Charles, Jose was invited to teach and choreograph in California.
Crossing the continent gave me time to think and collect myself. It was painful to go, but it was time I went. In my flight from New York, I had left one thing unresolved: Pauline Lawrence.
But coming to the rehearsal one day, at the 16th Street studio, there was this little red desk. We come in there one morning, and here Doris is sitting behind the little red desk. It's 10:45, you see, and here's this telegram. Open on the red desk. And we all go by, you know, pretending not to notice. And Doris has this funny little expression on her face. She says, "Go ahead, read it." So you pick up and it says, "Pauline and I were married today, signed Jose." Doris says, "Yes, now anything can happen, can't it?"
When a hip injury forced Doris into retirement as a performer, Charles took over classes at the studio. Jose and Pauline returned to the East Coast, where Jose began to choreograph under Doris Humphrey's direction.
He would never allow himself or his pieces to be formed in the same stage with Charles Weidman's pieces. Now, you see, there's something very deep in here. It was the best thing in the world for Jose, as the worst thing in the world for Charles. It was the worst thing in the world for Humphrey Wyman, because not only did we lose Jose, we lost Pauline.
Did you feel abandoned, Mother?
No. You can't feel abandoned. You feel maybe the shock of separation, and then.
But how did you feel about Doris helping Jose at this point?
Oh, that was fine. That was fine. I needed help, a great deal of help.
The war, by the spring of 1942, was gathering a hideous momentum, and it was only a matter of time before I would be called to the colors.
When I went in the service before the war, I did what a lot of boys used to do, and you could actually eat three times a day. Well, I was lucky enough that I was accepted before the war, and pretty soon the whole thing started, and I did say I didn't bargain for this. We were just boys, you know. I was 17 years of age in the Navy, and the war starts, and you can't believe somebody wants to kill you, you know, one minute to the other. Well, we certainly learned that they do that.
I think that when Jose was drafted into the Army, Pauline and my mother and Jose himself all realized that this was a major break in his career.
Jose spent his first few months driving a truck for the Quartermaster's Corps and was then transferred to Special Services. For 3 years, he choreographed and performed in shows that educated and entertained troops about to be sent overseas.
I'm glad that he didn't get into the fighting of it, because I don't think Jose was the kind of guy that was put on his world to kill anybody.
The Limón Dance Company made its debut at the Belasco Theater in 1947, with Doris Humphrey as artistic director, Pauline Lawrence as manager and costume designer, and Simon Sadoff as musical director. Their debut at the Belasco Theater was a startling success.
I knew Jose because he had been in the Army like I was. We had just gotten together sort of at the very back of every ballet class with the Ganova. He and I were nowhere technically, and we were so way in the back. And so we talked, and I went to see him dance, and he impressed me. So in the dressing room we talked, and so one day he said he'd like to do a piece with me.
My first meeting with Jose was at Jacob's Pillow. It was a very special time for me because it was my fifth summer at Jacob's Pillow, and I had also just come back from doing USO work at doing Oklahoma in the South Pacific.
There are very few people who could hold a stage and with the power, with so little said in movement, and hold the stage as well as Jose could.
Doris Humphrey created to the poem of Federico Garcia Lorca and the music of Norman Lloyd, Lament for Ignacio Sanchez Mejías.
Thank you.
romance is based on an old Italian legend dealing with the destructive power of jealousy, combining the elegant dance forms of the High Renaissance with the power and eloquence of movement and gesture. I have tried to give this ancient drama a new dimension, that of dance. You will see the four protagonists, the innocent wife, Desdemona, the treacherous false friend, Iago, Iago's gullible wife, Emilia, and the ill-fated Moor, Othello.
It was quite a real big important thing in my life. You had to be an actor first, and then you know to do those characters. And that is, I liked that, you know, because I feel more an actor dancer than a dancing dancer.
Repetitious theme. It's the wheel of fate. That's what it is. So the form is the message. He understood that very well. He had a fantastic sense of form.
Had this inherent nobility about him. It seemed to me just part of him. The realization that he's killed Desdemona needlessly, and he becomes sort of like the raging animal mourning its mate.
Curtain went up, you know, we just didn't know what was going to happen. And at the end, there was, you know, for a moment, there was silence, and we thought, we really died. And then the theater just burst open.
In 1951, Jose was invited to perform with his company in Mexico.
The cruel, heroic story of my native land has held a singular fascination for me. The confrontation of the blood and the culture of the European and the American Indian, resulting in centuries of unremitting conflict, has been resolved within me into something harmonious, into an acceptance and an understanding.
He went back as a great artist. No one had seen that as yet in the United States. I think there was a joy to be treated in that way and to see your picture on kiosks. All the great artists were gathering round. This was a very special time for him.
Was completely new for us, and it was a personality that it was stunning on stage, and everybody was like that. I never saw another person to dance like that.
Under the leadership of Miguel Covarrubias, who had been appointed dance director at the Instituto de Bellas Artes, composers, choreographers, painters, and writers were collaborating on innovative projects with substantial government support. Miguel brought José to a small Catholic chapel outside Puebla, which inspired the dance Tonantzintla.
The chapel was rendered in the language and out of the imagination and sensibility of the Indian. The forms were no longer the flowing curves of European design. They were related to the sacred sculpture of the Toltecs and Aztecs. Miguel knew the effect this was having on me. This was sublime theater. Both of us, renegade Catholics, rebels against our backgrounds, were, as artists, enraptured by the supreme presentation. Miguel explained that the chapel had been built on a spot where stood a temple to the mother goddess Tonantzintla, which had been demolished, and its stones used to erect the present chapel. Miguel designed the decor and costumes. The Little Mermaid was danced with ingenuous charm by Valentina Castro.
Nosotros estábamos un poco como impresionados, pero es como enamorados de también de su forma, de él, pero como de nuestra raza.
I deplore the artist who makes of his art a withdrawal from the travail of his time.
The raw, harsh, unpleasant fact is that communism is an issue and will be an issue in 1954.
I'm an honest American citizen. The Communist Party is a minority, but a dangerous minority.
Limón explored issues of loyalty and betrayal in The Traitor, his version of the story of Christ and his apostles. He cast himself in the role of Judas the betrayer.
The truly symbolic figure of our time is the traitor. It was my intention to use this only as it pertains to our own time.
You know, I still say that to go out and be Jesus Christ, that is, it's hard.
We like very much to have the audience receive a challenge, to meet us halfway if possible. We like to say, look, here is an idea. Will you rise to it?
I feel sometimes that he was in a certain primitive way in rebellion to his early Catholic upbringing. You know, José never talked about these things. He never talked about himself anyway.
His dancing was all about how he felt about should he betray the Christ, should he not. And I think he and Graham raised that dancing about emotional states to a very high art.
There have been so many traitors around us on both sides. I've been affected by their accounts of treachery and their confessions and self-justifications. I have a great pity for these unhappy human beings.
Limón was invited to tour under the auspices of the United States Department of State. Over the next decade, the company was sent to South America, Europe, and the Far East.
Doubtless, there were many circumstances in which he had to put on a face. It was necessary when there were official receptions. And I remember the company being coached with regard to its responsibility as cultural ambassadors. That was the term that was used. And we had to be on very, very good behavior, very, very careful in Eastern Europe, particularly. But I don't think that in any way would have compromised his sense of his role and contribution. It was thrilling. He was really, had been selected out as an exemplar of what it is that American dance culture could offer.
You know, I believe that one of the wonderful things about art is that it succeeds in communicating, I should say a national art, manages to be of value to to other nations in direct proportion to how intensely national it is. For instance, I think the reason why Johann Sebastian Bach is, to me, the most supremely great artist is because he was supremely German. And I think that the most wonderful thing about Shakespeare is that he was very English, and so on. I think that Michelangelo was the greatest Italian of Italians. So, in our own humble way, we're very proud of being American dancers. I would rather that mistakes be made in the cause of individualism than that there should be very expert conformism. I really would.
He could take a week with a curtain call. When he got downstage center, he took in everybody, from the top balcony all the way down, as if he was saying hello to each of them. When he finally got to the front row and the conductor, then he finally bowed his head and kept it down an appropriate length of time, and then finally looked up, you know, quite arrogant stance. They had seen an artist, and he knew they had seen an artist. There was a well-deserved smugness that he had about the whole thing.
Limon based the Emperor Jones on the Eugene O'Neill play of the same title. Limon played Brutus Jones, the character that Paul Robeson had made famous on Broadway. Hoving's role as the white man, he was transformed from colonial to profiteer to slave trader.
Fortunate in having the music of Heitor Villa-Lobos, the great Brazilian, who collaborated with me in a most charming manner, most heartwarming manner. That was one of the happiest collaborations I've ever had in my life. Important thing was not to do a choreographic version of the play, because of course you see that would be an impertinence. What was important was to find the crux, the nuclear of the O'Neill play, and to make an extension of it in choreographic terms.
Misa came from that time when we were in Warsaw, and he was walking the streets and asking, how do you have the courage to rebuild? That sense of separation from these people that were trying to rebuild.
Thank you.
Lisa is probably one of my most beautiful memories. I get moved when I think of it now, because I thought it was such a moving, these group scenes. Oh, God, I loved that piece. And of course, the music is so beautiful.
He seemed to be often positioning himself as an outsider, weighing possibilities. Jose is standing apart and looking at this group, trying to figure out how it happens. How can this be? And yet, can I join it? Can I receive the energy from it? And I think that was his, that was the story of his life.
That creature in Misa Brevis was for me the hardest nut to crack. I became the outsider that I am, that he was.
Everybody has the feeling of being outside of a place that you wish you were able to be a part of.
I remember being so moved by the crucifixes section, how he had developed those gestures of nails and swords with her own hands. That was both so, on some level, abstract and also so touching.
You know, he rebelled against the Catholic Church and muttered many times over that the church killed more people than souls saved by it, by engaging in warfare because you didn't believe the same way and things like that. And that annoyed him enormously.
Doris Humphrey, we lost in 1958. I have not become accustomed to her absence. She gave me very much. Absence is not mortality, not when you leave some great part of your spirit and essence to your fellow man. She left me, she left all of us who want it, the ineffable memory of her great symphonies. The formidable works of her middle period are lost forever. They were not recorded nor filmed.
What Doris did with musical theory was something to say with her democratic philosophy is an absolutely phenomenal thing.
I think he was very shaken by her death. She was part of the backbone of what kept him going. I heard a lot of complaining from other company people about the loss of Doris in terms of there isn't anybody picking up the slack here.
Limón made a choreographic offering in homage to his mentor, Doris Humphrey. He celebrated her memory by using movements from her own dances and reworking them in this complex ensemble work.
Had is that we can fly. We all want to fly, you know.
And then we fly in our imagination too, that we have these flights of fancy, these moments when our imagination takes us to far places on wings, unseen wings, nevertheless they are wings. So that this work is not about birds actually, it's about our obsession with the idea of flight. Very good, it's in very good shape, and considering the hour of the morning, it's wonderful. Now look, there's two things I'd like to ask you to do, please, while you're catching your breath, and that is this. When you are on the floor, on those rolls, the first one, sometimes you forget to lie down, it's very big, from this thing, really lie down. It's a very nice contrast from the high to the low, huh? It's about you and about me and about he and she and they. No, no, there's a shoulder first. Shoulder and then knees. I was more pleased. Ready? And what does our instrument do? Our instrument, which is the body. What does it do to say what has to be said?
He always held forth. There was a distance that he didn't want a bridge built across. I can remember doing Desdemona with him thinking literally I was going to be choked to death on stage because he had such intensity.
That quality that he had was sometimes greatly at war with the sophisticated New York modern dance, Juilliard School of Music environment that he was in. And I think that those moments when he collided with sophistication were probably ones of great anguish.
His main philosophy probably was, in spite of all the negative things that man goes through, that man is noble and is good.
I think that his Mexican upbringing and the religious part of that upbringing was very strong in him. Although he became a sophisticated American, he stayed in certain respects, I felt very much that Mexican guy.
One of the dance greats of all time. Unusual combination of instrument, temperament, sense of style, and a dedication to form and structure. This unusual even in musicians and architects. His pieces stand there like a piece of architecture, not sculpture, but that too.
In 1967, Limón was diagnosed with prostate cancer. 2 years later, he gave his final performance. One of Limón's final works was The Unsung, a tribute to 8 Native American chiefs.
Rituals survive in the lives of peoples, which we are sometimes erroneously prone to label as primitive. For instance, the dances of the original Americans. They have a great many very splendid and beautiful rituals, which are one of the treasures of this great nation.
1971, Pauline Lawrence died of lung cancer.
Jose did all he could for her, as he could. But again, he was, as we know, a man possessed in the most wonderful way. She didn't want to get in the way of any of that. We were with her. Jose was on one side of the bed and I on the other, and she just very slowly expired, quite peacefully. It was difficult, but of course. He lay out in the grass and sobbed. Orfeo helped him get through the loss of Pauline.
We were talking, and he was saying how the newer dance, or the avant-garde, how he was not able to feel akin to it. And I said, you have to be yourself. You cannot be anything else.
We are not interested in amusing anyone or entertaining anyone primarily. If our dance is entertainment, which I think it is, or of a high order, it's only incidental. It's only because we are people with certain ideals. We want to use the human body to speak of the dignity of man. I know that is what motivates me.
We arrived at another one of these kind of really depressing stages where there were no light bulbs in the dressing room and there were no chairs. At some point I went to Jose and I said, Jose, I don't understand why we do this. I think that, I mean, it just seems like, why should we bother? Do people really care? It was as though he pulled together every beautiful force in his body and in his mind. It really moves me. I mean, remembering this one moment, and he said, my dear, as long as we have a man in that White House like Nixon, we must do our work with every bit of courage and dedication that we have. And it just lifted the whole thing off of me. And I said, whoa, that's it.
Man, the artist, man, the humanist, the philosopher, the creator is one thing. Man, the politician, the scientist, and the militarist is quite another. The question is not, does the dance have a future, but does man have a future?
In 1972, Limon's health began to fail rapidly.
His pain had piled up in such a way, his physical pain, the pain of losing Pauline. And Jose, I think he didn't find a way to really release the emotional tensions in his life except through art.
We walked in with Pete. As much as he was hurting and as much as he was so
suffering,
he got up to hug Pete. And Pete said, don't you ever stand up for me. And he helped him lay down again.
When he died and raised up in the bed and made this cry, I felt he had seen something really horrible that just frightened him to death.